repeated in Psalm 15. And after that, we'll pray the Lord's Prayer together. And I guess you can go and hit that sunshine with God and call it. That's the dream scene right there. Let's read together from Psalm 15. If you've got a Bible, do open it up. Good to have God's Word open in front of us. And we're going to preach you through that in a little while. Have it open in front of you. Check, is what that minister guy is saying? Is that what the Bible's saying? Because this is the truth, and this is me explaining the rest of it. Psalm 15. Lord, who may dwell in your sanctuary? Who may live on your holy hill? In other words, who can live with God? He whose walk is blameless, and who does what is righteous, who speaks the truth from his heart, and has no slander on his tongue, who does his neighbor no wrong, and casts no slur on his fellow, who despises a vile man, but honors those who fear the Lord, who keeps his oath, even when it hurts, who lends his money without usury, so without trying to make loads of interest off it, as much as you can, and does not accept a bribe against the innocent. He who does these things will never be shaken. Okay, we're going to pray the Lord's Prayer today. Let's put it up on the screen. As well, so these are the words that Jesus gave us when his followers said to him, how do we pray? And we want to know how to pray. How should we pray? Here's what the Son of God said about how to pray, what to ask for. So let's pray these things together. Our Father, who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Great. Well, this is for you. Just want to say a big thank you to Matthew today, because we are improvising somewhat with our tech set up today, and Matthew has done a great job stepping in last minute to make solutions happen and just make sure that we can be heard on the microphone and the tune today. So if you just thank Matthew for a good job today. Good man. And stop tuning at that point to make sure the world and your team. Right, so did you guys go through with Dream Team Dom and Colin? And we'll see you guys at the end for a great team. Let's get some that. Yeah, go! Get out! Right, so when I preach, I often ask you a couple of questions as I do that, and it might be that you want to chat about it with people that you're sat with, or you might prefer just to sit and think about it for yourself. Let your body language demonstrate what you're going to do, things you're going to do. And we open a question for you. In your house, do you have house rules in your home? Or maybe when you were growing up, did you have house rules in your home? You know this sort of thing, right? The picture will come up in a minute. I've seen it in lots of people's houses. You know this sort of thing. You know, it's kind of a wooden thing on the wall. Be thankful. Try new things. Be happy. Be grateful. Show compassion. All that stuff. Have you got one of those on your wall somewhere? Or do you just have, like, house rules to say, while you're under this roof, this is how it's going to be? So we met to think of a chat. Have you got a house rule for? All right. So Psalm 15, I think, are the house rules for living under God's roof. I'm going to think about that and give it to go through. Who gets to live with God? That's the question, verse 1. Who may live their life in God's presence? So both right now in this life and into eternity. Who gets to live with God? Psalm 15 gives us a character description of the person who gets to think God's home is their home. So verse 2 really sums it up for us. It's someone with clean feet, so it's a blameless walk, clean hands, doing what is righteous, clean lips, so you speak truth, and a clean heart, so speaks truth from the heart, from a pure heart. The person who can say, I haven't put a foot wrong, there's no blood on my hands, I've spoken the word of God, and my heart has always been pure. So we're 1 minute in here, and presumably, you already know that that is not you. And it's certainly not me. Just based on today, it's not me. I can't imagine that anybody really believes that they are completely blameless in their walk through life. Their actions, their thoughts, their speech, their heart. When I used to work at Scripture Union, and I would go to primary school and descendants, and I would say, hands up, and some kids put their hands up as soon as you say hands up. Hands up to a volunteer. Amazing how many hands went up. You don't know what you're doing yet. What you volunteer for. Hands up if you've never done anything wrong. Like, half of you want to go like that. Some of the B7s, like that. Yes, you have, I saw you right. But, you know, honestly, most of us know we have all put a foot wrong, got blood on our hands, spoken untruths, don't have a pure heart. Keep listening though. Keep hearing in these short verses of Psalm 15 what it is that God values in people's characters, in his household, in his family. Because what you're going to hear are God's house rules. This is how things are going to be under my roof. Now, there is a way that you get to be part of God's family, and probably quite a lot of you will be able to telegraph that from a mile if you're going to hear that gospel truth again. But somebody here, maybe a few people here, might need to hear it for the first time. We'll get to that. But let's just say a bit more of this character that we're reading about. Verse 2, doing what is righteous. Now, righteousness is not about being holier than thou. It's doing what is the right and just thing in a relationship. So in relation to your wife, your husband, the kids, your grandkids, your neighbor, your colleagues at work, your God. Doing what is the right thing and just thing in relationship to them. That's what it is to be righteous. So doing what's right by your means. And when it comes to God, worship is always part of that. What is right by God is to worship him. So if that's lacking, then we're not doing right by God. Still in verse 2, speaking truth from the heart. So an integrity about your speech, such that people know that when you open your mouth, what comes out is going to be true. And this is more than just being the kind of person that's like, I call a spade a spade. I will always be honest, you know, I hear some people that are quite proud of the fact that I'm not hiding anything, I'm not going to lie, I'm just going to be honest. Even if that honesty is stemming from an injured heart and nasty thoughts. So speaking the truth from a pure heart is what is being called for here. True and upright speech, true and upright heart. Firstly, God twice says, and when God repeats it, you know it's really important to him. He twice says in this verse, no slander. No casting a slur on your fellow man. Of all the things that I read in these verses, I think, through my observation, my experience of life, including amongst Christians, this is the one that's most openly and brazenly disobeyed. The amount of times I hear people talking about others in negative ways, casting slurs, slandering, in gossip,
in conversations with friends, in staff rooms, in canteens, across multiple workplaces. Again, going back to my SU days, I've seen plenty of school staff rooms and been there for the D-rates. Massively so on social media. It's a world of passive sort and slander. Do you think it's far too commonplace a thing for people to open their mouths and spout judgmental pronouncements about the motives and the actions of others, usually without any effort to understand the person or situation? This really is an area of our ethical lives that we must pay more attention to, because God repeats, let's say again, in this verse, He does not want slander on our tongues. Also in verse 3, does no wrong to the neighbor. So more broadly than wronging people with what we say about them, God wants us to bless those around us rather than curse them with our words and actions. So does his neighbor no wrong? That's the words here. They come again in the New Testament, in Romans 13, verses 8 to 10. Listen to what Paul says here. Let no debt remain outstanding, except the continuing debt to love one another. For he who loves his fellow man has fulfilled the law. And the law of God is really coming towards love the people around you. The commandments, do not commit adultery, do not murder, do not steal, do not covet, don't be envious of what's around you. And whatever other commandments there may be, whatever other commandments, are summed up in this one rule, says Paul, love your neighbor as yourself. And then he says this, love does no harm to his neighbor. So consider, are you loving your neighbor? Little checklist, am I doing any harm to them? There's a kind of a restraining thing about love. There's a proactive blessing thing too, you know, having a blessing on your, but there's a restraint called for in loving your neighbor. That's Paul. That's him summing up the second, this is a part of the Ten Commandments. If you're part of your Ten Commandments, you'll know that's kind of most of the second half, about how we treat other people. The first part's all about how we treat God, how we relate to God. And this is what Jesus said in Matthew 22. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul and all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. So is a challenge. Is that your view? Do you love God as the first thing with all you've got? And then Jesus said that the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. All of the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments. This is all summed up in love God with all you've got, love your neighbor as yourself, which includes do no harm, restraint from doing harm. So that is God himself, that's Jesus, God incarnate, saying, there's two things I want from you. Love me with all you've got, love those around you in real, everyday ways. So what does that mean to not do any harm? Don't seek to drag people down. It's easy when we feel that we've been hard done by them. We'll drag them down. Don't set on people when we're way up. Hear this a lot from people in the workplace. You know, what should we do as a Christian? We do be different to those around there, just setting on each other to get up. Don't do that. Don't fester in bitterness or seek to get your own back. Don't jump on social media bandwagons to express your disdain or otherwise hurt people. You know, it doesn't feel like a real world, but it is. The real world, the real people in the around them. Love your neighbor with your restraint as well as your proactivity. Verse 4. Despise the vile man, but honor those who fear the Lord. So this is really about reacting rightly to the character that you see in other people. So when we're being told, don't slander, don't slur, don't do any harm, it's not saying,
everybody's brilliant, you know, let's all hold hands and sniff and deal with daisies. Like, there are people that are violently apart around us, amongst us, in our communities, in our nation. It doesn't mean starting to disdain for them. Remember, we're not to harm or slander. It does still mean reject them rather than indulging the shameful things that some people can see the prize and be admired for. So let me give you some examples. Like cutthroat leadership in work or politics. That often gets admired. People look at that and go, yeah, good on. But it's a vital thing to be despised. Lavish lifestyles of opulence at the expense of poor often get admired. I want that thing, I want that life. Maybe I'll stop my charity giving so I can get out of that. But that's a vital thing to be despised. There are role models in media and music who portray money, sex, and power as the three gods. And where people's bodies and their best years and their talent get exploited, that happens. People admire it. That's a vital thing to be despised. So understanding, being discerning about where there is vile character at work in people, and having nothing to do with that, that's right. Slandering and broadcasting judgment is not. Keeping promises when it hurts, verse 4. Now look, anyone can make a promise in sunshine, but can you keep it when it rains? Know what you promised. I mean, if you spent time at all, like, looking back over what are the promises I made, what are my commitments, what are the oaths I've made in my life, what did I actually need to stick to because I promised that, I committed to that. Stick by that promise, and when circumstances test that promise, that's the moment that your character shines in the way that Psalm 15 calls for. Keep your promise even when it hurts. Not even when it seems convenient, even when it hurts. When it hurts your wallet, when it hurts your pride, when it hurts your reputation, keep your promise. Because you know what? Your commitment matters to God. And that other stuff, your wallet, your pride, your reputation, he doesn't care about that. We might, but it's nothing in comparison to how God sees your commitment to both of you. So, summing up, a lot of what matters to God for life under His roof is really how you use your money and how you use your mouth. How do you use your money? How do you use your mouth? So let's pay attention to what needs attention here in our lives. I'm going to ask you another question, and a bit more to after that, just a simple question. You might want to just sit and think about this. It's a personal question. If you want to chat, of course you can chat. Of all the things you just heard, being through in Psalm 15, which area is God really speaking to you about? You know, the Holy Spirit has a habit of, when Scripture is preached, there's just sometimes something that's like, ooh, wow, that's me. I need to do something. So did that happen? Has the Holy Spirit kind of lit up for you? Actually, you need to do something about that. What is that area that stood out to you? Okay, from Psalm 15. 3 minutes to think. Or chat to you about that.
Okay, I said at the start, none of us live up to these house rules. There are none of us who qualify for having life with God, either now or in eternity, based on how we've lived and thought and acted and spoken. God is holy, God is perfect, God is pure, and there is no sin in his presence. We don't qualify. As the previous Psalm 14 says in verses 2 to 3, the Lord looks down from heaven on the sons of men to see if there are any who understand, any who seek God. No, all turn aside. They have together become corrupt. There's no one who does good. Not even one. It's not that none of us ever do any good. There's no one who is wholly good. Which brings us back to the question that starts Psalm 15. Lord, who may dwell in your sanctuary? Who may live on your holy hill? Well, in Romans chapter 3, Paul quotes those words from Psalm 14. There's no one righteous, not even one. And he spends three chapters in Romans making that really clear. So he says to kind of non-religious people, he says, you're living like this. You can't be with God, can you? And all the religious people in the sermon's going, yeah, give it to them. And the next chapter is like, and you religious people, you're living like this. You don't qualify either. What? And so he's the playing field is like, there is nobody who qualifies for life with God. Paul spent a bit of time doing that. And as Paul goes on, God, he said, there's no one worthy of life with God. But God considers you worth living with him. So much that he did this. Romans 3, 22 to 25. This righteousness from God, here that means being right in God's sight, this righteousness from God comes through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. There's no difference because all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified freely by his grace, by his gift, through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. So by the gift God gives in Jesus, that's how. God presented him as a sacrifice of atonement through faith in his blood. In other words, folks, you are made right before God when you believe that Jesus died for you to take all the punishment that is due to us for our wrongs before God. Jesus did two things to qualify you for life with God. Now and forever. So he lived the perfect life. He perfectly lived out Psalm 15. All the things that we've looked at about character. If you look at Jesus, his life, how he lived it, absolute 100% perfect match. And he offered that to God on your behalf. This is the same thing. Jesus didn't do that and kind of say to the Father, well, I did it. They might not have, but I've managed. He offered that perfect life and said, this is for them, Father. I offer this to you on their behalf. And he died on the cross to atone for every wrong step of our feet, every harmful action of our hands, every lie of our lips, every shameful secret of our hearts. That's why Jesus went to the cross, to be the perfect sacrifice, atoning for those things by his blood, by his death. So it's because of Jesus' life, because of his death, and also because of his resurrection to life again, that those who believe, those who place their trust in Jesus, get to kind of stand behind him, get to say, we live with God. We will dwell with God now and forever. So a simple but really important question for each one of you, is that you? Are you living with God? Are you aware that is the life that you now have? You live with God, you're under his roof. Are you confident that that's what your eternity is going to be? Do you know thanks for living such a life for years now? Or it might be that you're just starting this life with God today. It's a prayer. I'm not railroading you to praying it, but I offer it. And if you want to take it and use it as yours, go ahead. So that's amen at the end. So we're quietly around that. Let's pray. Father God, thank you that that's what I get to call you, Father. I get to live with you, to be under your roof, in your family, to belong to you always. I confess to you, Father, the ways that I realize I have sinned, where I have put my foot wrong. You use some of them now. Where I have not loved because I have harmed. Where I've loved things that you call vile. Where I have flaked on my promises. God, where I slandered and gossiped. Where I've harbored impurity in my heart. I haven't sought to throw it out, I've just kept it and dwelled on it. Where I've spoken dishonesty. You know, Father, there's no point pretending with you. You see it all. This is me. This is what my life has looked like. Hand on heart, I have not lived out the house rules. That's why I'm so grateful for you, Jesus. Thank you, big brother and son of God. You have lived these rules out perfectly. You have offered to the Father for me, for everyone who stands behind you, this perfect life you've lived. That you've offered yourself on the cross to die for all the sin that I've just named. And even all that I haven't even noticed or admitted. Jesus, thank you. For the total assurance and the massive gift that your life and death and resurrection are for me, getting to be with you now and forever. Holy Spirit, help me. Now I'm home with you, God. It feels like a big thing to be able to say, I'm home with you. I want to live out the house rules. I want to be more like Jesus. Holy Spirit, help me grow more like him. 1 year from now, let me be more like Jesus than I am today. 1 hour from now, let me radically throw out the things that you've shown me need to be out of my life. In Jesus' name. Increasingly over time. Your will be done in my life, Father, means I'm going to be a bit more thoughtful about how I use my money and how I use my mouth. Just because the kids break the house rules, as we do, it doesn't mean that the parents throw them out of the house, right? God wants you home with him. He has paid a huge price in the death of Jesus to make that happen, for you to be home with him. So he's not going to shut you out. So you can be assured of your place in that family. But now it's time to grow up. It's time to grow in the family likeness, to live out God's rules. So over time, our prayer is that the Holy Spirit makes us more like what we're reading here than we were yesterday. Not only, actually, because that's better for those around us, and it really is, we live like this, blessing to those around us. Not only because that honors God, who wants to see life under his roof lived like this, but because, as Psalm 15 concludes, he who does these things will never be shaken. Folks, what we just read, this is a solid life. This is a solid, unshakable way to live. Walking the straight path, acting in the right ways, speaking honestly from a healed and pure heart, keeping your lips free from slander, loving your neighbor by doing no harm, including through use of money, despising vile character, but dispensing with judgmentalism, keeping your promises not just when it's inconvenient, but when it really hurts. All of that makes for a solid life. And a life that, because Jesus won it for you, will endure forever. Amen. So we're going to sing more songs of praise, and let's stand in it. We'll be seeing coffee at the end of our worship, so please sit back and have a coffee chat. It'd be great to chat a bit from here. Yeah. machines forgive me. I trust. Lord, I'm not ready. Make me courageous anyway. Lord, I'm in love with you. I never say it enough. Maybe never said it before, actually. But I am. You are home to me, God. Holy Spirit, be with us all, now and evermore.